أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين. الحمد لله والحمد حقه كما يستحقه حمدا كثيرا، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين، خاتم النبيين، شفيع المذنبين، سيدنا ونبينا وحبيب قلوبنا وطبيب نفوسنا، أبي القاسم المصطفى محمد. وعلى آله الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين الذين أذهب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. واللعنة الدائمة الباقية على أعدائهم أجمعين. أما بعد، فقد قال الله تبارك وتعالى في كتابه المجيد، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم: وجعلناهم أئمة يهدون بأمرنا وأوحينا إليهم فعل الخيرات وإقام الصلاة وإيتاء الزكاة وكانوا لنا عابدين. آمنا بالله، صدق الله العلي العظيم.
إيتاء الزكاة وكانوا لنا
عابدين. Elders of the community, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam and Iman, السلام عليكم جميعا ورحمة الله وبركاته.
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد.
I've taken the opportunity this evening to recite verse number 73 from Surah Al-Anbiya, where Allah Azza wa Jal explains the responsibilities and the duties to those whom He gives the authority and leadership. The prophets were given authority. Prophets were the leaders of their times. In the same way, the successors of the prophets who were appointed by Allah Azza wa Jal, they were also given this duty, they were also leaders, they were also imams, they had the authority. But how do they fulfill this authority? How do they fulfill these tasks that Allah Azza wa Jal had placed in front of them? A leader who is appointed by the people in a country will have to follow and will have to fulfill the tasks within the boundaries, within the constitution of that country. So he ensures that his leadership, his authority that he has is practiced within the constitution. Anything outside the constitution, he could be charged.
So he ensures that
he could be taken to task.
His leadership, his authority,
Allah Azza wa Jal also in providing this authority, provided the guidance.
Anything
what does Allah
outside
say?
The constitution,
this is Surah Anbiya.
He could be taken to task.
And
Allah
we have made them
also
imams.
Providing this authority,
provided
if I refer to
Surah
Al-Baqarah, what does Allah say? This is Surah Anbiya.
Verse number 124. You will be familiar with this verse because
and
it is related
we
to
have
that personality.
Imams.
Whom we are going to remember soon.
To Surah Al-Baqarah,
And that is Nabi Ibrahim.
Verse number 124.
What does Allah say?
You will be familiar with this.
That Allah says to Nabi
because
Ibrahim.
Because it is related to that personality.
Or Allah reminds the prophet, our prophet.
We are going to remember soon.
That Allah tested Ibrahim.
And that is Nabi Ibrahim.
وَإِذْ ابْتَلَى إِبْرَاهِيمَ رَبُّهُ بِكَلِمَاتٍ.
Nabi Ibrahim.
He tested him.
Or Allah reminds the prophet,
when he tested
our
him.
Prophet,
Nabi Ibrahim
that
fulfilled those tasks.
Ibrahim.
When he fulfilled those tasks,
Ibrahim,
Allah Azza wa Jalla tells Nabi Ibrahim, "Inni ja'iluka lin-nasi."
When he tested him,
Imama.
Nabi Ibrahim fulfilled those tasks.
At that time, Allah did not
when
tell Nabi Ibrahim, "Inni ja'iluka lin-nasi rasula." Inni ja'iluka lin-nasi khalila. No. He told him, "Inni ja'iluka lin-nasi imama." And remember this, that this position of imamat Nabi Ibrahim alayhi salam achieved was after he had become Nabi, was after he had become Rasul, and when he passed through all those stages, after that Allah appoints him and tells him, "Ya Ibrahim, you are imam over the people." So we have to understand one thing, that this position of imamat is not a political position. Do not think, if you are, I'm not saying you are thinking, but if you feel, if you understand that this is a political position and this happened after the death of the Prophet, no. It's not a political position. This is a divine position. And when it is a divine position, it is given by Allah Azza wa Jal. And therefore Allah says, وَجَعَلْنَاهُمْ أَئِمَّةً. What is the first task? يَهْدُونَ بِأَمْرِنَا. They are going to guide by our commands. They are going to guide by our commands, not by their own. Even our prophet, who is the chief of all the messengers, who is chief of all the prophets, Allah says, وَمَا يَنْطِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَىٰ إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيٌ يُوحَىٰ. يَهْدُونَ بِأَمْرِنَا. Guides by our commands. And then Allah Azza wa Jal says, وَأَوْحَيْنَا إِلَيْهِمْ فِعْلَ الْخَيْرَاتِ. Now that they are going to tell, they are going to guide people by our commands, Allah Azza wa Jal says, we revealed to them performance of good deeds. My elders, brothers and sisters, this part of the verse is very important for us to understand. That A'imma Tahirin alayhimu salam, when they were given the position of authority, there was one thing that they were told very clearly, and that was, فعل الخيرات, you have to do good deeds. We will come to an example just now. You have to do good deeds. Even those who were given this authority, who had so much of knowledge, that any person who is given, all the imams who have been given the position of imamat, I'm talking about the successors, the true successors of the Holy Prophet, one important condition that they must have, and one important quality that they must have is, that they have the knowledge about the rest of the people. No one can defeat them when it comes to the knowledge. So when they had this knowledge, when they had people who used to come to them, Allah Azza wa Jal tells them, فَعْلَ الْخَيْرَاتِ. Understand one lesson. If the imams who were given this authority were told to do fi'l al-khayrat, what about us who are followers of the imam, who are followers of the prophet and the successors of the prophet? Isn't this message also not very clear for us? We will come to it, as I said just now. وَإِقَامَ الصَّلَاةِ وَإِيْتَاءَ الزَّكَاةِ. Establishing prayer and giving of the zakah. وَكَانُوا لَنَا عَابِدِينَ. Elders, brothers and sisters, there is a specific reason we have assembled this evening. And the purpose is to commemorate the Shahadat anniversary of our ninth Imam, Imam Muhammad At-Taqi Al-Jawad, salawatullah wa salamuhu alayh. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. And it is always my principle that whenever we gather during such occasions, and when I get the opportunity of delivering the majlis or the lecture or the mahfil during such occasions, I want to talk about that imam. And the reason why I want to talk about that imam is that though this imam lived many, many years, thousands of years before our time, but their examples are so relevant today, so important today, that we can look at their lifestyle and we can practice those examples and we can put into practice those examples. Our imam, amongst all the 12 imams, 12 successors of the Prophet, is the one who lived the shortest life in this world. Only 25 years. We have brothers sitting over here who may be nearing 25 or may have just passed 25 years. During that time, 25 years, Imam had that great responsibility to fulfill. How did he fulfill those responsibilities? We have to reflect upon that. Imam had two titles, or he is known famously by two titles. Amongst us, the Indo-Pakistani community, whenever we talk about our ninth Imam, we will always address him as Imam Muhammad At-Taqi. If you go to the Arabs, and when they remember him more with the title of Al-Jawad. So he had both these titles. At-Taqi, the pious. Al-Jawad, the generous. Let us look at some of the important points in the life of ninth Imam to understand. Point number one. My elders, my brothers, sisters, this is the Imam who attained the position of imamat at the age of 7 years and some months. You may be questioning just now, but you're not the only one who is questioning. You know, during the time of eighth Imam, I am talking about the time when our ninth Imam was already born and he was 3 years old. Someone asked our eighth Imam, one of the companions, "Ya Mawla, if you pass away from this world, who is going to be the next Imam? Guide us, tell us, because you can pass any day. You can die any moment. Just provide us the guidance, who is going to be the next Imam?" Imam told him, "It's going to be my son." The ninth Imam gave him the name. Imam Ali Rida alayhi salam, his first child, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad, was born very late, in the year 195 AH. He passed away. He became a martyr. He was attained the position of shahadat of an eighth imam in the year 202 AH. In 195, ninth imam was born, and that's the first son of our eighth imam. People used to question that. And when imam was born, 3 years, and that person asks this question, imam guides, that he is going to be this son, that is ninth imam. Mawla, how will it be possible? 3 years old. And imam answered, Allah Azza wa Jal appointed Nabi Isa as a prophet in his stall when he was still an infant. Quran mentions, Surah Maryam, Allah Azza wa Jal says, that when people asked Bibi Maryam alayhi salam, what have you done? And this child, whose child is this? Who is the father? Bibi Maryam had taken a vow, had made nazar, that she was not going to talk. So she kept quiet and pointed towards the Nabi Isa. At that time, the people said, how is it possible for a child, a baby, to speak? You are asking us, telling us to ask him. At that time, Nabi Isa said, Inni Abdullah Ataniyal Kitab wa ja'alani nabiyya. He said three things together. I am servant of Allah. Allah has given me a book. Not only that, he has made me a prophet. Quran says this. We should not be surprised that at the age of 7, our ninth imam had already attained the position of imamat. Now let's continue with this and to say, how did people know that he was true imam? This question is not only something which bothers us today or something which we inquire and ask about. Even during that time, there were people who were not ready to accept anyone as imam. Anyone who claims himself to be imam and he would go and say, I am imam. People were not ready to accept them very easily. There used to be a test. There used to be an examination. When our eighth imam passed away, people from Baghdad, Iraq, and people from other countries came to Medina to find out who is the next imam. They come to Medina, they go to the house of the brother of our eighth imam. Name was Abdullah, son of our seventh imam. And there were people who were advocating that he is the next imam. They were not pointing towards Imam Muhammad Taqi, no. They were pointing towards Abdullah, brother of eighth imam. So they go there. Remember, people who have come here to Medina, and this is a delegation of 80 people. These are very well-known people. These are people who have come, who have studied, in their places, in their towns, they are known as respected scholars. So these are people who have knowledge, who have had communication with the imams before. Now they come in the presence of Abdullah and they say, we want to ask you questions. Right? I'm going to mention the questions. I'm going to go through this very quickly. The first question that they mentioned was, what is the status of a person who tells his wife that I have divorced you many times as there are stars in the sky? Try and understand this question. I gave you introduction. These are ulama. This is not any time pass question. This is a question that comes and says, what is the position of that woman who has been told by her husband that I have divorced you? That many times as there are stars in the sky. So this person replies and says that her position is that she has three talaqs. In other words, this talaq now is irrevocable, this divorce is irrevocable, and she is taliq, finished. The ulama were surprised. Ulama were surprised immediately. This is not the answer we received before, but they did not say anything. Second one stood up. Pardon me, I'm saying this question, right? And this question was, again, it's not a very, we may think it is a silly question, but this is something which is happening, of course, not within our community, but in the times and in the world and the era we are living, this is happening. Next question was, what is the punishment given to a person who has a sexual relation with an animal? What is the position? What is the punishment? Again, the reply is given, and the ulama, the scholars are surprised. Now, they are worried, because the answers they had received before, not the answers. Suddenly, in that assembly, from the front of the assembly, a door opened. And one of the servants came out, and after them comes out a young boy, who is none other than our ninth imam. And all the people who were sitting them stood up in respect of the ninth imam. And that servant tells the people, this is the imam after the eighth imam. So they sit down there. And the same person who had asked that first question comes to the imam and says, asks him, what is the position of that woman who has been told by her husband that I have divorced you as many times as there are stars in the sky? At that time, imam said, don't you read the Quran? Allah says in Surah Al-Baqarah, At-talaqu marratan. Now imam is not giving an answer straight away. The answer comes through the verse of the Holy Quran. Okay. After answering that, imam told him, yes, if you have given divorce two times, you can bring her back, right? But if you give her divorce third time, then it becomes irrevocable, and then the rest of the masails of the Sharia, I'm not going to go through that. And then the second person asks the same question about the relationship with an animal, and imam gives the reply. At that time, now this is the lesson that we need to understand and to take from here. At that time, those ulama told the imam, but this man pointing towards Abdullah bin Musa has given reply this way. Imam told his uncle, oh uncle, be careful of your duty towards Allah. Be afraid of Allah. What are you going to answer to Allah on the day of judgment when he will ask you as to why did you give such replies when there was someone more learned than you in your presence? Why did you give such answers? Let's go to the Quran. This is the lesson. فَاسْأَلُوا أَهْلَ الذِّكْرِ إِن كُنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. Ask the people of dhikr, of those who remember. Ask those who know. If you do not know, don't go and take your answer from any person. Recite salawat, please. A person comes in the presence. I like telling stories, and so a person comes in the presence of ninth imam and says, Mawla, I come from this particular place, far away, I think it was in Iran. I come from that place. This person comes to Medina, tells imam that the person, the governor of that place, is demanding tax from me. He's demanding tax from me. And I don't have. But Mawla, you know, he is one of your followers. Why don't you write a letter of recommendation and ask him to please forgive me that amount? He has the authority, he has the right to forgive me this amount. Please write one letter of recommendation. Imam said, I don't know who that person is. He said, Mawla, you do not know who that person is, but I'm telling you one thing, that he is one of your followers, and I am sure that if you write a letter of recommendation, then he will forgive me. Imam wrote a letter. I'm not going to read the whole letter, but a part of the letter Imam said to that person, addressing that governor, he said to him, do good to your brothers and know that Allah the Almighty will ask you about everything, even to the weight of an atom and a grain of a mustard. Do good to your fellow brothers. Clear instruction. Historians have written that this person takes the letter. He is now traveling to his town. Some distance, some miles before the town, before reaching the town, he finds that the governor is there to welcome him. The governor is there to welcome him, and the governor is asking him, where is that letter which my imam has given to you? He gives the letter. Person kisses the letter. After kissing the letter, when he opens and reads the letter, he says, I have forgiven you the tax, and as long as I am governor of this place, you are not supposed to pay land tax for your land. You are free, you do not have to pay. My message is only one, which I have taken, and this message is from ninth imam to all of us, the followers. Do good to your brothers. Believe my dear brothers, sisters. We know when you want to help a mu'min brother, and when you do sincerely help a mu'min brother, you do not know, you will not be able to realize, we will not be able to comprehend what we have sent for hereafter. Because on the day of judgment, when we will see that reward in front of us, we will be questioning Allah Azza wa Jal and asking, Ya Allah, what is all this for? And it will not be surprising if Allah says, you help one of my servants, you help one of my creation, and as a result of that, all this you get. I want to add a little over here and to say, agar tamara thi saru thai shake, to saru karo, koik nu buru na karo. If you are able to help someone, help someone. But if you are unable to help, don't spoil his work. Don't do bad to him. Let's take this message very clear. Let me come now to the final story, whereby it will explain to us also the relationship between Quran and Ahlul Bayt, number one. Number two, it will explain to us how there were people who were envious and jealous of the imam, and as a result of this, they plotted to have the imam killed. During the time of Mu'tasim was one of the Banu Abbasi Khalifa. A person comes to Mu'tasim and tells him, I am a thief. I agree. And I confess. And I want you to apply the Islamic punishment. Must be courageous, isn't it? goes in front of Khalifa and tells him, Uchorcho. Je karwanu che kari nakho. At that time he goes there. Khalifa says, okay, there are scholars sitting there. Says the Quran says the order is cut the hands. But from where? Quran does not say from where. So one of the alim says, from his wrist. What is your proof? The proof is that Allah Azza wa Jal says regarding tayammum, right? That this is Surah An-Nisa, Allah Azza wa Jal says, وَامْسَحُوا بِرُؤُوسِكُمْ وَأَيْدِيَكُمْ. Talks about that, so it talks about cut off the wrist over here. Okay, the other one says from the elbow here. What is your proof? He says, Allah says in the Holy Quran regarding wudu, Surah Al-Ma'idah, verse number 6, okay, that you wash your hand ila al-marafiqi. Our ninth Imam was sitting, this is Baghdad, Imam has been called to Baghdad, Imam is sitting there in that assembly, and Mu'tasim addresses our ninth Imam and says, Ya Aba Ja'far, you tell me what is your opinion. Imam said, but the ulama have already given their opinion, why do you want to ask me? Mu'tasim says, you have to give your opinion. Imam says, please forgive me. Please forgive me. Don't ask me to give my opinion. Mu'tasim said, you have no other way but to tell me what is the right punishment. Imam said, you cut off his fingers from the joint here. Now the ulama are looking at the ninth Imam. And Mu'tasim says, what is your dalil? What is your proof? And Imam says, the Holy Prophet has said that when we go into sajda, 7 parts of our body should touch the sajda. Should touch the earth that is on the ground. The forehead, the 2 palms, the knees, the toes. So you cut off this, the palms will still be touching the ground. And then Imam brought the verse of the Quran. وَإِنَّ لِلَّهِ For the place of sajda belongs to Allah Azza wa Jal. That is the places of sajda, meaning the forehead, and all this belongs to Allah Azza wa Jal. So you have no other way but to just cut off these 4 fingers. Mu'tasim said, obey the order that has been given by Abu Ja'far, that is our ninth Imam. And then Imam went away. Abu Dawood, jo ulama mein se tha us waqt, 3 din ke baad, मुअतसिम के पास वापस गया और उसने मुअतसिम को कहा, आप जानते हो कि उस वक्त हम सब बैठे थे, यही किस्सा याद करके वो बयान कर रहा है, हम सब बैठे थे वहां और अबू जाफर ने वो फतवा दिया, तुमने वो फतवा कबूल कर लिया और उस फतवे के मुताबिक उस आदमी की उंगलियों को काट दिया. मुअतसिम आप जानो, मुअतसिम अरब को पसंद नहीं करता था. मुअतसिम अरब को पसंद नहीं करता था, वो तुर्कियों को ज्यादा पसंद करता था. उसके जमाने में तारीख की किताबों में मिलता है कि उसने 20,000 तुर्कियों को इराक लेके आया था, 20,000. और जो उस वक्त सियासत के जो खास मुकाम थे वो तुर्कियों के हाथ में थे. وہ ترکیوں کو زیادہ پسند کرتا تھا اور اس کو اہل بیت مطاہرین کی طرف بہت بہت نفرت تھی. وہ بہت اس کی کوشش ہی یہی تھی کہ اہل بیت طاہرین کا ذکر اور نام ختم ہو جائے. ابو داؤد جانتا تھا کہ ایک ہی جگہ ہے اور ایک ہی وجہ ہے کہ جس کی وجہ سے میں ابو جعفر کے نام کو ختم کر سکتا ہوں یا ابو جعفر کو قتل کروا سکتا ہوں. جاتا ہے معتصم کے پاس اور اس بیان کرنے کے بعد اس کو کہتا ہے کہ تم جانتے ہو کہ یہ لوگ یعنی شیعان امام امام کو کتنا پسند کرتے ہیں, امام کی ہر بات کو مانتے ہیں, امام ان کے دلوں پر حکومت کرتا ہے. اگر آپ نے کوئی راستہ نہیں نکالا تو یہ لوگ تیری مخالفت کریں گے, یعنی شیعہ تیری مخالفت کریں گے اور یہ تیری حکومت چل جائے گی. بس یہی بات کرنی تھی کہ معتصم کے دل میں ایک خیال پیدا ہو گیا کہ کیسے امام کو قتل کیا جائے. عزاداروں, خدا ہم سب کو کاظمین کی زیارت نصیب کرے. عزاداروں سوچئے ذرا کہ ہمارے امام کی عمر فقط 25 سال کی تھی, فقط 25 سال, جوانی کی حالت تھی. عزاداروں معتصم نے حکم دیا کہ امام کو زہر دیا جائے. عزاداروں یہ زہر میں تاریخ کی کتابوں سے بیان کرتا ہوں کہ یہ زہر اتنا قاتل تھا. عزاداروں اگر آپ سوچتے ہو کہ امام کا انتقال ایک ہی دن میں ہو گیا تو یہ نہ تھا. عزاداروں کئی دنوں تک یہ زہر کا اثر جسم میں پھیلتا گیا اور امام کو یہ تکلیف ہوتی رہی. عزاداروں کیسی حالت میں امام نے وہ وقت گزارا ہے وہ تو خدا بہتر جانتا ہے, لیکن تاریخ یہ لکھتی ہے کہ امام کے ایک ایک جسم پر یہ زہر اثر کرتا گیا اور امام تکلیف میں تھے اور اپنی تکلیف کو ظاہر بھی کر رہے تھے. عزاداروں تاریخ میں اختلاف ہے کہ امام کا انتقال کون سی تاریخ کو ہوا, لیکن مشہور ہے کہ ذلقعد کا مہینہ اور 29 ذلقعد کو امام کا انتقال ہو گیا. عزاداروں امام کو غسل دیا گیا, امام کو کفن پہنایا گیا. تاریخ کہتی ہے کہ امام کے جنازے میں ہزاروں کی تعداد میں لوگ نے تشییع کی اور جس مقبرے قریش جہاں امام کا روزہ ہے امام کو دفن کیا گیا. عزاداروں ہمارے امام نوے امام اپنے جد امام حسین علیہ السلام کو یاد کرتے تھے اور جب بھی موقع ملتا تھا امام پر روتے تھے. میرا دل کہتا ہے کہ اس وقت امام کی روح کربلا طرف پرواز کر کر کربلا کی طرف رخ کر کے یاد کی ہوگی, اے جد بزرگوار میرے جنازے کو تو اتنی شان و شوکت سے لے جایا رہا ہے, یا جدہ آپ کے جنازے پر آپ کے جسم پر آپ کی شہادت کے بعد ارے گھوڑے دوڑائے گئے, ایسے گھوڑے دوڑائے گئے کہ آپ کا جسم پامال ہو گیا تھا. ارے یا سب ہے جو مجھے دفن کرنے کے لیے تیار ہے. ہائے امام زین العابدین 11 محرم کو جب امام کے جنازے کو دیکھا تھا ایک مرتبہ امام کے چہرے کا رنگ بدل گیا تھا اور امام ایسے شکایت کر
وَسَيْعَلَمُ الَّذِينَ ظَلَمُوا أَيَّ مُنْقَلَبٍ يَنْقَلِبُونَ. إِنَّا لِلَّهُ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ.
I'm only requesting you to join me in one dua, and we pray for all the mu'mineen and mu'minat in different parts of the world who are suffering because of injustices and oppression. Ya Allah, bihaqqi our ninth imam, Ya Allah, relieve them of their sufferings. Ya Allah, those who are doing dhulm and injustice on this earth, Ya Allah, destroy them. And we pray to you to hasten the reappearance of the imam of our time. Ajjalallahu farajahu sharif, Matam Hussain.